Hello, it's good to have you join us on our program, Plus Flow, coming to you from NTA Lagos Network Center. We like to say that we enjoy the privilege of inviting into the studio distinguished Nigerians to come and speak to us about some, well, not necessarily troublesome spots in our lives or in our societies or in our country, but critical areas where we think that all Nigerians should be able to come to the table and offer the way forward, either to change the ascendancy of some problematic areas or to re-establish the fact that Nigeria can become one of the greatest nations on the face of the earth if all of us can just work together. Today again, yes, we have as a matter of fact, a very distinguished Nigerian, you know, the health profession, taking out degrees both from here in Nigeria and also from Cardiff, you know, that is outside of Nigeria. She is into occupational medicine, and so that tells you a lot already, because we are going to be looking at our well-being. And specifically, we are looking at the issue around malaria. Everybody says malaria is a threat to virtually every single one of us, whether we are poor or we are rich, whether we are educated or we are illiterate, whether we are fully and gainfully employed or we are job seekers, but particularly children. And I'm sure that is why many of us will be concerned once the issue of malaria comes to the table. So our guests will be looking at where Nigeria is and the question of the incidences and the mortality, you know, arising from malaria, you know, fever, malaria attack, malaria ailment. Are we doing the right things? Are we looking critically at the figures? Are we getting the right responses from government? How about us as citizens? Are we speaking up to let our government know exactly what we needed done? My pleasure to welcome on your behalf there for today, Dr. Tokunbo Babajide. You are come to Close Floor.
Thank you.
Now, quickly, we just need to understand this because I'm sure many of us, we seem to know what malaria is. So we don't need to go back over that anymore. But how bad is it when we look at the statistics? Nigeria is 160 million. So the incidence of malaria in Nigeria, how bad, really? I mean, don't let's hide anything now.
Now, looking at the incidence of malaria in Nigeria, there has been global improvement. And with Nigeria, there has been improvements as well. But in terms of where the figures and where we are today, we are not doing very, very well. I mean, Nigeria records in 2015, based on the World WHO World Malaria Report, there were 212 million cases of malaria
globally.
And Nigeria has between 50 and 100 million. So that's not good enough.
Doctor, say that again.
Yes, Nigeria records between 50 and 100 million cases of malaria annually.
40 to 50% of the total global figure?
Exactly. Yeah, so that's what it means. And also, I mean, globally, there were 429,000 deaths recorded, I mean, based on the recent figures.
Yes.
And Nigeria is doing about 200,000
deaths from malaria.
Nigeria has 30% of the burden of malaria in Africa. So really, we are a big country. I mean, we know
we
are 160 million people. But also, in terms of the expertise we have, the Nigerian government needs to spend more. In terms of
Before we come to spending, maybe we should first even begin to profile the needs. So we're saying our government actually must pay more. So what happened to the Rollback Malaria Initiative? Well, that seems to have died.
No, it hasn't died. The Rollback Malaria Initiative is still on. I mean, these are the mosquito nets, the mosquito-treated nets, the indoor spraying, you know, and also the control of the environment. These are part of the Rollback Malaria Initiative. Don't forget the rapid diagnostic tests. So the Rollback Malaria Initiative is still on in Nigeria and is on globally. So it's not dead. But one of the things we need to know is the country that have, there are so many countries that have recorded, a number of countries that have recorded eradication of malaria. Yes. In the last 10 to 15 years.
Eradication of malaria.
Eradication of malaria.
On the continent or outside of the continent?
In and around the continent, globally. I mean, one of the things that WHO has at the moment is this global technical strategy on malaria, which for control of malaria for 2016 to 2030.
Yes.
And the goals are, one, to reduce the incidence of malaria by 90%.
That's almost like wiping it out.
Almost like wiping it out. By 2030. To reduce the mortality by 90% as well. To make sure that more countries, at least 35 countries, out of the 91 countries that are currently endemic for malaria, have eradication of malaria. And the fourth one is to ensure that countries that have had malaria wiped out, that it doesn't recur again. You know, so progress is being made globally in terms of control of malaria. I mean, the incidence of malaria based on the 2016 report shows that by 2015, or at the beginning of 2016, the incidence of malaria had reduced by 41% globally.
Will have come down by 41%.
Has come down.
By 41%.
Globally. That's by at the beginning of 2016.
But is Nigeria included in that global figure?
Nigeria is included in that global figure. But what it means is that because we are not making good progress, our own incidence has reduced. But it's not a very good figure.
It's not significant.
It's not significant.
Yes, because from the figures I'm saying here, we are hearing stories like malaria kills a child in every 30 seconds?
Yes, every 2 minutes a child dies from malaria. That's globally. You know, but this is a figure that as now is an average figure. But what it means is that for a country like Nigeria that has a heavy body, the figures will be higher.
Now, okay, let's bring it back before we become too alarmed about this. Let's bring it back to the street. So, what do we need to do as a people, as the government, as citizens? What do we need to do? Because we have now the prognosis for Nigeria will probably be dicey if you look at the large space that you have to deal with, the large number of persons you have to deal with, and then the environmental control that you need. So what do we really need to do urgently?
Now, you said something about before we become too alarmed. Let's remember that Nigeria is making progress. But compared
I like that.
To
that's
what,
reassuring.
Yes, no, we're making good progress. I mean, there are a lot of hospitals you will get to, for instance, the organization I work for, where malaria is not treated until the rapid diagnostic test or until another form of test, you know, is used to diagnose malaria. I mean, those are the things that WHO has recommended. And there are a couple of hospitals that are doing that. The teaching hospitals are doing that. A lot of public hospitals. So we are making progress. But compared to our population and compared to what has been done in other countries, our progress is not rapid enough. So let's not be very alarmed.
Okay.
You know, we are making some progress.
But we should be focused.
We should be focused. We should be focused. We should spend more. You know, and we should campaign more. You know, we should provide the insecticide-treated nets more. We should do more in terms of, for instance, the places that will have that have the heaviest burden are, of course, the rural areas.
Yes, yes.
In the urban areas, we know what to do, and a lot of urban in the urban areas as well. You also know that mosquito bites tend to occur between dawn and dusk. But a lot of people in rural areas that don't have this information, you know, they don't know what to do. They don't know about the control of their environment. You know, so we're making progress. I mean, right now, if you look at the number of families that have at least one
mosquito
treated net, it's increasing. So we are making progress. So let's not be too alarmed. We are making good progress, but we need to do more compared to what we have, the population we have in Nigeria.
Okay, I like the encouraging part. I like the encouraging part. That's being optimistic now, so that we can now begin to ramp up on that.
Yeah.
Now, okay, let's come back to the urban areas where at least we know some people are educated and therefore they should be able to know how to control the environment.
Yes.
Now, when we were growing up, we used to have the, I don't know if you understand this, the woolly woolly, you know.
Yeah,
yes,
I do.
The sanitary inspectors
yes,
who
I do.
Would come into the environment to see if your gutters are cleaned, if the drains are working, so that you don't have mosquitoes infest. So why did we lose that? Is that modernization?
Well, that's a very good question. But you and I know that a lot has happened in the country in the last couple of decades, especially 2 to 3 decades, that have resulted in a lot of instability. I mean, we've had coups, we've had a change of government. You know, so of course with instability, things will change. Sometimes you will lose things that are good. You know, sometimes you will just not be in focus. So this, I would say, are some of the reasons why we have lost track of this thing. But the sanitary inspectors are fantastic. Because you see, one of the things we need to know is that you can't rule out public health. I mean, that is where the bulk is. That's where the bulk of the work is in terms of control of disease. We need to attack it from the roots. We need to prevent the disease. And the public health officials, the willy-willy, like you said, are helpful. The doctors and nurses are highly skilled. They can't go there, you know, but they can do the work of educating from house to house.
From that grassroots level.
From the grassroots level. I mean, they inspect, they see things are not right. It's not just to inspect and sanction you. In the process of the inspection, education occurs, you know. So these are things that I think we need to revisit. I mean, late Professor Olukoye Ransom-Kuti, he was very knowledgeable, but he kept talking about
public health.
Public health. You know, primary care, prevention. We can't rule that out, you know, and the government needs to really focus on, in fairness, the government has been focusing, but compared to our population, are we doing enough?
That actually is the question.
Are
and that question
enough?
Is begging for an answer.
Yes.
So are we really doing enough? No, we're not doing enough. Now, so what the way forward for us, what are some of the recommendations you'd like to see? You know, so that we can begin to occupy, you know, I mean, in terms of health reaction to our public health, can we begin to see some action both on the part of government, maybe corporate Nigeria, and the citizens themselves?
Now, talking about, you know, I mean, like I said, are we doing enough? You know, we try to encourage, you know, but also let's face the fact that, I mean, a lot of government, either at the state level
or federal,
level or local government level, we don't look at the country or we don't look at the area we govern holistically. We need to pay attention to governing holistically. When you have the policies in place, it's not just enough for the people that sit around you to tell you that, okay, this is what we are doing. And it's not just enough for you to go out as a governor or, you know, as a commissioner or chairman and go and launch a program. It's very good to open the hospitals. It's very good to open the health centers. But how are they distributed? You know, and what are the figures? We don't do a lot in terms of data collection. We need to collect data. For instance, you're opening hospitals, you're opening up services. Collect the data. How distributed are they? Is it well distributed? And this is where the problem of Nigeria is. So really, I think the programs are running. I mean, we have a lot of professionals, you know, but in terms of distribution, are we paying attention? We can't just be fine in Lagos, you know what I mean? Or be fine, you know,
in Abuja.
In Abuja, and then forget those in the interiors. They are part of Nigeria. And that is why the figures are really, that's what
that
is giving that bad. I mean, Nigeria, you can imagine Nigeria, Pakistan, and Afghanistan having the poorest. You know, you can't, I mean, it's shameful,
yes.
You know, let's face it,
yes.
That we are being rated with Pakistan and Afghanistan. I mean, this is not where we should be, you know, and I think what is drawing it back is nobody's paying attention to the interiors. We need to pay attention to the interiors. Those in the village are also like us, you know.
And sometimes they come into town anyway.
They come into town, yes. They come into town. So whatever program that we are doing, we're providing the mosquito-treated nets, we are providing these, we are providing that, we should make sure that, I mean, a country like Papua New Guinea has done remarkably well.
Yes,
in terms
it's been
of,
reported that they virtually actually cleaned out malaria.
And they have, and for them, you know, why it is remarkable is because the geography is not particularly very, you know, favorable. You know, they don't have
in the tropics.
Right in the tropics, and they don't have all the good roads and all that. But they've paid attention, you know, because they've realized that everybody in the rural area is as important as those in the urban. So we need to pay attention. So whatever it is that we're doing, we need to make sure that it is well distributed.
Okay, now again, that is a nice one coming from there. You have taken example from my mouth. Papua New Guinea, just a tiny country, very close to us here, and yet they have been able to do that. So, what lessons can we learn from what they have done in Papua New Guinea? What lessons?
Good. I think the lessons is there's nothing else. It's primary care.
So you go back to Professor Liquid.
We go back, you know, to primary prevention. We can't rule out the campaigns. I mean, this is good, you know, that these are part of the campaign tools, you know. We need to campaign.
Keep saying this.
And then the mosquito nets need to be distributed. So those that can't afford it, you know, provide them with the mosquito net. And also one of the things, even in the urban area, there's one area that is important we talk about, which is important in the control of malaria, is to ensure that, you know, before you get yourself treated, make sure that you get a test. even in the urban areas. I mean, I've had patients tell me that, doctor, you never get malaria test positive in your hospital, you know, so, and I feel I have fever, I'm sick, you know, I think I have malaria, so why am I not getting it? So a lot of people are not happy with what WHO has said, but you see, this is very helpful. And one of the reasons is the drugs that has been recommended. I know we are not there yet. The ACT, that's the artemisinin, you know, combination therapy. WHO has warned us that for the next, for several years to come, there is no alternative. So once there is resistance, it's like, look, where do we go?
Yes.
You know. So, and that is one of the reasons why we have to make sure that we reduce resistance to these drugs. Make sure you get treated. A lot of illnesses are viral illnesses. You can have the fever, you can feel ill, you say, oh, I know how my malaria does me. I mean, let's come to town, you know, let's come down to earth. You know, that's how people say, oh, I know how, when I feel like this is malaria. You know, but a lot of times it is not. It is, there's only a few cases that come out positive. So also in the urban areas, we can also, the campaign is also useful in this regard. You know, let people know as much as possible. Doctors need to talk to the patient. Doctors need to embrace it themselves. Yes,
because this campaign, it must go viral.
Yeah, because you see, once there's a lot of pressure on you, and you are not convinced that, you are not even convinced as a doctor or as a health practitioner that your patient doesn't have malaria. There are so many private hospitals that are still, you know, once they come, I think it's malaria, they give them
just rule of thumb.
They just rule of thumb, you know. But the doctors themselves need to be very convinced, or other healthcare practitioners, very convinced that, look,
this is actually malaria.
This is actually malaria. Let's get it treated. Let's get it tested, I mean, before we get it treated. That's one of the things. Now, once the health practitioners can all embrace that, then we can now focus on the population. Or the patient comes, the client comes and says, oh, I have malaria, doctor, I'm not happy, you're not giving me anything. We educate them. Once you educate and convert that person, it goes and educates others, you know, and the campaign spreads.
That's good. Now, let's come back to what, again, because I like what you have just said here. Yes, you have said the roadblock malaria is still there. The action plans are still there, though we are not seeing much of that on the street. Now, how do we, not only as practitioners now, but as citizens, how do we on our own begin to rally to the point where the environment that is within our confines? So when do we begin to take responsibility for making sure that we control the environment before the mosquito begins to, you know?
We take responsibility now.
I like that. Now.
Not tomorrow.
Not the next election.
Not everybody takes responsibility now. Because you see, within our confines, you have a role to play. You control your environment. You control your neighborhood. You can control your environment, your neighbor, you know, it's, you see, oh, you encourage, educate, enlighten them. Let them know that, oh, this malaria is not anything to joke with. So it's now. And we all have a role to play. Now, for those that have privileges, I mean, you know, to be on air, or maybe they hold positions of authority, advocacy, they should influence the area. So we all start, and we all start now from where we are.
They should influence the area.
The area.
Not just by social, through social parties.
No. They should influence their areas. Because, you know, it's one of the oldest diseases, but it's also one of the deadliest.
Yes.
And the figures coming from Nigeria show that these are not things to joke with. I mean, our leaders need to understand. I mean, governance in Nigeria is somehow is different from in other places. And things have changed, in fairness. But even at that, more and more of our leaders need to understand that those in the rural areas are part
of this same,
country. And whatever it is that we are doing, we need to make sure. I mean, Rome was not built in a day. It's not going to happen overnight. But we should increase the efforts. We should continue until we get, you know, to everyone in
the
area.
Okay, now the long-lasting insecticide nets, now that you said we should have more of that distributed, does that portend any danger in any way? Shouldn't we be worried about the insecticides themselves?
No. I mean, like you said, every chemical, you know, is a poison. Somehow, it's just to find out to what degree it affects you and in what quantity you're using it's been used. But I think in the quantity in which those mosquito nets have been impregnated, it's been proven to be safe. Because initially, you know, they were lasting for 6 months and then you retreat them. But it's been found out that, you know, once you give people for 6 months, a lot of times you can't get it back. So right now they tend to last for 3-4 years. But it's been proven, I mean, weighing this against the benefits, they've been put in doses that are safe for everyone.
For human consumption, as it were. Okay. All right. Now, but what about the spraying?
Good. Now, don't forget that even for the mosquito-treated net, there's the problem of resistance as well.
Yes. After a while,
you know, because also the mosquitoes themselves now, so it's not just the
mosquitoes are smart.
It's not just the parasites that have become resistant to the drugs, but even the mosquitoes themselves have become resistant. And it's been recorded in about 60 countries that they have
cases
of resistance to the chemicals, you know, either in the nets or the insecticides that you spray, the indoor, you know.
Because I had a friend, I don't know, there are all these chemicals that sell out around, you know, and then she reported that she had been spraying the room and the mosquitoes refused to die.
So these are the cases of resistance, you know, to insecticide. But also, I mean, like Nigeria, it's kind of a kind of complex society. Don't forget that every now and again, once anything comes, you also find people that tend to take advantage. So there have been adulterated chemicals as well.
So the chemicals are not what they should be.
Those are part of the problems. But you know, we don't give up on the battle.
Yes, we just keep, you know, we just keep on.
And then the government agencies can do what they can to then get these bad eggs out of the society or out of the system. They get caught every now and again,
Something you mentioned in passing here that maybe we need to dwell on will be the question of surveillance. Do we have the proper... Okay, you seem to agree with that.
Yes,
I do. Do we have the proper disposition to surveillance to know where the likely spots, the hot spots of malaria attack and all that? Do we have all that?
We have the knowledge. We have the professionals. No, not just the knowledge. I mean, I'm taking it one at a time because that's the most important thing. You know, we have the knowledge. You need to have people that know, you know. We have the knowledge. We have the policies. Now, in terms of what is being done, it is being done, but, you know, the areas to focus on in terms of the surveillance are really more of the interiors.
And that is not being done.
It's been done, but
sporadically.
Yes. But also, there are the vulnerable groups, I mean, the pregnant women and young children, which account for the highest number of cases. I mean, for the 429,000 global death, 303,000 of them are children. I mean, we're children, you know, so it's a high number.
Almost like 80%.
So they're a vulnerable group. And those are the, in terms of surveillance, those are the group to pay attention to.
Now, but I just chipped in just now that, okay, we seem to have the knowledge, but we don't have all the other tools that we need to do the surveillance. Could that be right?
Well, I will say yes. One of those that will be required are the community health workers, you know, like we have rightly mentioned, the health inspectors.
Yes.
These are some of the things that some of them would be able to do. But we have schools training community health workers,
are we deploying enough of them to actually have this coverage? Because what you are saying now is that, yes, we may have attention paid to urban centers, whereas the rural areas may carry the bigger burden.
They carry the bigger burden, but, you know, don't forget that there has been a lot of work by international organizations. I mean, WHO is not resting. We have the National Control, you know, program for malaria. We have and the Gates and Melinda Foundation are doing a lot as well. I mean, the USAID, we should commend the US, because it's the largest single contributor. Yes, it contributes about 35% to the funds, being raised to control malaria. So the work has been done. But in terms of what we get in Nigeria, is it adequate? It's not adequate. Because if it is adequate, we won't have the figure that we are recording. And in terms of the figure that we are recording, the Nigerian government needs to do more. I mean, I've just said the U.S. contributes 35%. But for the countries that have, like tiny countries like Papua New Guinea, their governments have taken it upon themselves.
As a national project.
And they have contributed heavily to the control of malaria, or to the health of our health budget is something.
Yes, it's less than 10%. Now, doctor, let me quickly come to this because it's also good that we try to if nobody praises you, try and praise yourself, you know, just like the Agama lizard. Now, seriously, we got polio out. We kicked polio out of Nigeria.
Yes.
2 years back.
Yes.
Polio was no longer endemic in this country.
Yes.
Do you think we can get to that, we can push ourselves to that point with malaria?
Oh, definitely.
You believe that?
Oh, I believe it, absolutely. I mean, because like I said, the WHO has now the global technical strategy for malaria 2016 to 2030 hopes to eradicate malaria. Right now, malaria is endemic in 91 countries as at the beginning of last year. Compared to the figures in 2000, it was endemic in 108 countries. So we are making progress.
But we would like to see Nigeria on that.
We would like to see Nigeria. And we would like to see Nigeria out of the groups with countries like Afghanistan. Because when we are not in the same category with countries like Afghanistan, then we know that we're doing it. We know we're doing the work. We know that, yes, we are really deploying. And then we're spending the way we should spend on health and on the control of malaria.
Okay, let's come back to remedies or remedials. The World Intellectual Property Organization, WIPO, is interested in having generic drugs that will not be too expensive, that will be available to the poor families. I mean, since it will appear as if malaria is the hardest hit will be the poor families.
Mm.
So what are we doing? Are we signatories to those treaties?
Well, in terms of generics for control of malaria, Nigeria is like we have poor country, we have poor communities, we have the rural areas. We've just highlighted this. And no matter what we are getting from the international organizations or whatever it is that Nigeria is contributing, it can only go alpha. So the generic drugs should be supported. I mean, are being supported, but we need to make sure that the whatever generic drugs are being produced or are being supplied or are being introduced have been gone through the proper tests, and the efficacy is guaranteed. So in that only then can we say, okay, because at the moment there are many generic drugs, antibiotics in the market.
Yes.
So it's fine with the generic drugs.
You actually support that?
Oh, yes. Absolutely.
I like that. She's not going to go anywhere because we have so many other issues that we're going to raise with her. But we'd just like to take a break and take a breather so that all of you can also join in the conversation. By the time we come back, we expect you to come in with your questions or your comment or probably your suggestions on the way forward in our fight against malaria. So stay with us.
When we came up with the team, say, Operation Zero Tolerance, we were saying zero tolerance to deaths on our roads. We are saying having zero crashes, yes, on our roads.
We love to see you in Dashiki or Dandogo or Agbada.
The youths still have a very big chance of making a very big difference. That's why I started a lot of projects.
We have not been able to distinguish traditional medicine from traditional religion.
Every edition is an arresting conversation with distinguished Nigerians from various strata of the society, bearing their minds on how we can realize the Nigeria of our dreams. Join us live on Closed Flow, Monday and Friday, every week here on NTA2 Lagos Network Center. Closed Flow. The conversation is about you. Thank you for staying with us. We still have the doctor in the house. So far, she's tried to reassure of us we should not be too alarmed. Yes, malaria is killing on a large scale, but she's saying that, yes, the government is doing something, but we can do more. There's always the reason for us to do more. Now, critically, I'm just a little bit worried, though. Why is it taking us forever to come up with a vaccine? I would have imagined that for an ailment that has a global impact, is it because it's a tropical thing, it's the developing nation thing, that's why nobody is thinking of the vaccine?
Well, that may not be ruled out. However,
I like that. As sad as that may be,
yes,
it may not be ruled out.
It may not be ruled out. However, there is good news. A couple of vaccines have been developed, and at the moment, one is actually as is close to being licensed. for use. Okay. And the pilots will be run in three countries.
From Nigeria?
Nigeria is not included, though, sadly, from 2018. And it's worrisome, you know, to know that Nigeria, with the heaviest burden in Africa, is not among the three countries where the pilots will be run. Because I would have expected Nigeria to be one of them.
So is it because we are not pushing the right envelope? Or is it because we our government is not engaged the international organizations appropriately? Is that why we are not included?
I want to be sure that, you know, don't forget that for countries, I mean, like Zambia, you know, that have done a lot in terms of the control of malaria, you know, for international organizations.
They draw attention.
Not just drawing attention. You want to look at what is on ground. You want to run a pilot, you know. It's going to be run in different stages. So for those countries, you know, so maybe a lot of things will probably depend on what they have on ground for them to be on that list.
And that is why we need to ramp up on our
own. We need to ramp up. And maybe advocacy, lobbying and all that. But whichever way, it's sad that we're not on that list.
That pilot will run for how long? You don't know? Like 2 years, 3 years, 4 years?
I think it's going to run for about 2 years, because for the children that were tested, I mean, they given the vaccine at 0, at 1 month, and the fourth dose was given at 24 months. So it's something that should run for about 2 years.
Wow. That's encouraging.
It is.
So we are saying that the children will be the first to benefit from this, because they're one of the most vulnerable.
Oh, yes. Absolutely.
Okay, quickly, let's thank all our viewers who have sent in your heart. Well, Doc, I think it's your day today. You have quite a number of questions to deal with here, you know. So we want to thank all of you for sending your questions and your comments. So let's get out to knock them off one by one. Isaiah from Ikorodu. Malaria has come a long way. What is the WHO doing about it? Or are they just seeing it as an African problem alone? Well, you almost answered that now. But
okay.
You can just...
Okay.
You can
well, in terms of what WHO has done, I think we need to commend WHO. WHO has done a lot. I mean, a lot of the data I've given are from the WHO World Report on Malaria. And it's a comprehensive report. So WHO has done a lot in terms of the control of malaria. And I just mentioned
the global
technical strategy for the control of malaria, which I will highlight again, just for him to know that WHO has done a lot, which hopes that by 2030, 90% the incidence of malaria would have reduced by 90%. The mortality from malaria would have reduced by 90%.
And that's a lot.
That's a lot. That malaria will be eradicated in 35 countries out of the 91 currently. That's a lot. And to ensure that in countries that where malaria has been eradicated, they don't come back again. You know, so WHO is doing a lot and is pushing really hard. I mean, WHO is working with all the global
partners,
the international donors. WHO coordinates a lot of the funds and acts as intermediary between the countries and the donors. So in terms of what WHO is doing a lot in terms of the control of malaria.
But I think the flip side of that is that the domestic governments in all countries around the world must also be at par with WHO, otherwise we are not getting anywhere. That's what you're saying.
Exactly. And I would repeat, for countries that have been able to eradicate malaria, the domestic governments have played major roles in eradicating the disease.
Okay, so Isaiah, I hope you hear that. So you better make sure that you are speaking also directly to your government. Malaria has been... Well, I don't have a name, I hope. I'm not... Idris from Ojota. Can't all hands be on deck the way it was for Ebola? Governments, individuals... Or is it because the rich can manage malaria by traveling abroad? That is Idris from Ojota.
Okay, I mean, thank you, Idris. That's a very good comment. But however, you need to understand the difference between the two diseases. Ebola is a disease that is highly contagious. Yeah, it's contagious even to the healthcare worker taking care of you.
Yes,
you know, so So that's the difference between Ebola. But however, also, you need to also understand that the distribution of malaria is different from Ebola. I mean, Ebola came, and even in the countries that where others eat, I mean, I'm looking at Liberia, you know, the figures are not even as high as 10,000.
Yes.
You know,
malaria,
we're talking about 50 to 100 million cases in Nigeria. Yeah. So, and the funds that have been devoted to malaria, I would say, you know, is much more. But the difference which you need to understand is that the two diseases have
Far apart.
They are different in terms of, you know, the vector, the transmission, the control. And when you're controlling something that is everywhere, you know, sometimes it looks like you're not doing anything. But with the use of the insecticide treated nets, and the number of families that have at least one in their homes shows that though Nigeria has a long way to go, a lot has been done.
Now, the nets, can't we produce them locally?
We can produce the nets locally, I mean, I would say. But, you know, don't forget that, like every other thing in Nigeria,
It's suspect, though.
It's a Nigerian story.
Idris, that should be your next interest, because what doctor is saying here is that the government is trying to do something, but if you look at the numbers, you will know that we are still very far from it. Bidemi from Isheri, a lot of case studies have been done by students during research and projects on malaria. Can't Health Ministry refer to these researches for lasting solutions?
Very good. You know, you have a very good point. And really, like you said, students have done researches, professionals have done researches, and this will go a long way. But also, don't forget that in a country like Nigeria, the researches are also limited, because I would assume that the research that the students will do, you know, will actually require a lot of funds.
Mm. And the funds are not there.
You know, so it can only, you know, go
that
far. You know, so you have a very good point. They've done a lot of research. One, the government needs, and the health ministry needs to refer to this research, but also there has to be a proper coordination between what is being done.
Between the researching institutions and then the government itself.
And the government agency. And at the moment, I would not say we don't have that, because, I mean, the Federal Ministry of Health is doing its best. But for those students, I mean, once the lecturers see, or the professors see, or the academia see that, oh, this is really useful, this is something new, I believe that it will be passed to the appropriate quarters.
Okay. Something just occurred to me. Why have we failed to go back to our herbs, our, you know, local, you know? Yes, after all, our parents seem to be able to manage malaria when they were growing up. So how come suddenly that modern life and the common anti-malaria that all of us grew up with?
The chloroquine.
I mean, so what happened to when the quinine came, then we lost everything.
I mean, don't forget that there's resistance to chloroquine right now, so yes. It's no longer. But now, for the herbs, it can be used. I believe in a lot of societies, they are probably in a lot of communities, they are doing it. But, you know, in terms of what WHO is doing, and in terms of what the medical world is doing, one for the herbs, you can't even quantify the dose. You know what I mean? You know, and in terms of the campaign,
well, Doc, that's really my worry. Why have we found it difficult to codify these things up till now? Why are we still using this oral knowledge? Why?
No, don't forget that, I mean, in terms of the interface between traditional medicine and the orthodox medicine, where it is, for instance, I mean, in with infant mortality rate, a lot, when WHO realized that in the rural areas, the traditional birth attendants, play a major role. What yes. did they do? They train them, and they are working with them, and they are constantly training them, working with them, teaching them infection control practices, you know. So in terms of the herbs, they are not being ruled out, but what can only be done with them is, what do they contain? Now, these herbs we are talking about, do they contain the artemisinin-based combination that is being used now?
Yes.
You know, so that's the question with the herbs. So somebody needs to
research into that,
see what. And you know, don't forget that that's the same base we're using now. You know, the research actually came from China.
Yes, because don't forget again, in China also, Orthodox and traditional medicine are actually side by side.
Yes.
And they have they have codified some of their own.
Yes.
So you think we should be looking at that?
Yes. I mean, if there are those that are working in that area, I believe that that if we can have that intermediary, you know, it's going to work.
It will help.
Yes, it will help.
Okay. So all of us, we have to talk about that. Gregory from Victoria Island. Some communities lack basic social amenities, especially drinkable water, to survive. So they store water in buckets, thereby breeding mosquitoes. What is community health workers doing?
Okay, well, what you have said, you know, don't forget that if you're, Gregory, if you're storing water in buckets, you are storing the water to use.
Yes.
And
it's not the same thing as
the stagnant water. The stagnant water we are looking at are the stagnant water in the community,
yes,
you know, broken bottles on the road,
drains.
Even in the compound, in the premises, the bad drain that is not flowing. Even, I mean, you find a lot of places, even in Victoria Island, where you find that drainage is not flowing.
Yes.
And that is where the government needs to work. In the urban areas where they have the knowledge, in terms of the infrastructure, we have the good roads, but are the drains flowing? These are where we breed mosquitoes.
Especially the drains that have been blocked by new buildings.
By new buildings. And there are many of them, even on the island.
Yes.
So
those are the things you should talk about. Those are the things we must rally and get government to control.
So Gregory, it's not the water.
Keep in the house to drink.
No.
Well, that's another point again. We all seem to think that we know how mosquitoes actually are bred. You seem to want to correct that, because that's what Gregory is assuming now.
No, yes. So Gregory, that's not correct. You know, that they are bred in your buckets of water. I don't have water. What do I do? They are bred in poorly kept environment. So good hygiene, you know, good housekeeping is so important. Keep your environments clean. You may not be the richest person, but make sure that your environments are clean. Even the refuse. There are areas where not only breed rodents, but they can also breed
mosquitoes.
So we need to make sure that the refuse are being packed early. We need to make sure that we don't have broken bottles all around and things that can stop water, stop stagnant water,
yes,
where the mosquitoes can breed.
Okay, great. That's good information for you. Nifemi from Shomolu, does a chemical used on the insecticide net have any negative effect on the user, because some pregnant mothers complain that it causes catarrh?
Well, don't forget that there may be those that have hypersensitive airways, so you can't rule that out. But however, there is an instruction on the use of this mosquito-treated net. When you bring it out, you don't use it immediately.
You sun it or something?
No, you don't sun it. You actually spread it out in a shaded area for, I think, maybe for a couple of hours. I think less than 24 hours do before you use it.
I see. And
yes.
A lot of people may not remember that.
And a lot of people may not remember. And a lot of people might not have even read the instruction. So with that being done, if there are people that are sensitive to it, those are probably just minorities. And then they need to see the healthcare professionals,
yes,
practitioners, and
yes,
then they will be able to sort them out.
Okay. So, well, we have many more questions to handle here. Now, we have a target date, 2030. Did Nigeria buy into that?
Oh, everybody. All countries have
signed up
into that. It's
you think so?
Yes. It's possible.
We can interrogate our Minister of Health over this to be sure that Nigeria has signed up on this?
No, yes, because it's the WHO technical strategy.
And that is shared to all countries?
It's shared to all WHO member nations.
So we expect that Nigeria should be able to buy into that.
And really, what does it say? It's not anything different. It's just essentially the things that we are doing to control malaria. And it's this is just a document. But what the document says is, by the time we make sure that the insect-treated nets are being used, the vectors are controlled either by that or by the indoor spraying, and also that we make sure that the diagnosis is being done.
Yes.
You know, before treatment is being implemented, and that treatment also, one of the things is, which is important to mention, when you suspect you have malaria, when do you treat? Immediately. You get treated. When do you get tested? You test yourself immediately. So if you know whether you have malaria, then you treat it. If not, because you see, the longer you wait, the more you increase the morbidity from malaria. the more you are likely to get severe malaria. So when you notice that you feel malaria, or
so
you feel ill,
tested.
Go and get tested to know whether you have malaria or not.
Don't just assume that you have malaria and start treating yourself.
No, you should go
and get tested.
No, we should stop the treating malaria without the test. If the test says you don't have malaria, then if it is cold, if it is cough, you know, you take vitamin C, you take the things, you know, that has been recommended for you to take. And then, and not even antibiotics, because that's another problem. That's another problem, you know, for another day, antibiotic resistance. You know, so you make sure that you take the things that will treat the symptoms, and then the whatever foolish feelings you're feeling will disappear. But get tested.
Now, we have to come back to the children, because many of them, I mean, they're not vocal. They can't tell you exactly the way they feel. So how do you begin to know that, yes, well, okay, for a child, for instance, what would the mother, you know, how would she know that this is likely to be malaria, and then, you know?
Yes, okay, one of the things we should have actually talked about are the symptoms of malaria.
Yes.
What are the symptoms of malaria? Fever, you know, and you know, there are the three phases. I don't know if you have heard about the three phases of malaria. You have the cold phase, you know, the hot phase, and then the, you know, the sweat phase. The symptoms of malaria: fever, you feel chills, you feel like vomiting, and those are the things you're likely to see in children. Fever, very high levels of fever, such that in some children they may have convulsion, especially with children between 6 months and 5 years. So those are fever, poor appetite, a child doesn't feel like eating, no matter how young, a child doesn't feel like playing, the child may have cough and catarrh. Those are things, the child may have diarrhea. In children, these are symptoms that can occur with malaria. But typically, the symptoms of malaria are essentially fever. You know, you can even have some children coming up with joint pains or body pains, you know,
just
or
like
even adults, just like adults. But fever. When you have the fever and you get tested, fever, you have chills, you are sweating, and you know, typically it has a cycle.
Yes.
And that's
yes.
why a lot of people that says, oh, I think it's malaria, a lot of us don't have that cycle of malaria, because you know, the symptoms tend to last for about 6 to 10 hours, and it comes in cycles of every other day. But that's the typical malaria. But a lot of people that come with high fever, that is not. So a lot of times it's just maybe a viral illness
yes.
that comes, that will pass away, or that comes with a cough and the catarrh, or just a flu. You know, that will pass
yes,
away.
Yes.
So
that's why it's good to be tested, because without a test, you can't actually be sure if it is malaria or not. Okay, so we'll take that from you, that we will get tested. Now, the next thing will be the fact that, this is just funny to me, how did we get to know that actually mosquitoes carry the parasite? How did we discover that? How long did that one take us?
Malaria was first discovered, I think, in 1880, thereabout. So it's an old disease.
Reported, yes.
Yes, reported. It's an old disease. It's been around for a long time. And how does mosquito... It's not even all mosquitoes that cause malaria.
Yes.
It's the Anopheles
mosquito.
Yes.
When we were growing up, we learned that in school.
Anopheles
mosquitoes. The Anopheles are still around?
They are still around. They are very much... and they're still biting.
And only the female.
Only the female. And typically what happens is when the mosquito bites you, if it is an infected mosquito, it introduces the parasite into your body and it gets into your bloodstream.
Well, say that again. So the mosquito must be infected itself.
It must be infected. If it's not carrying the malaria parasite, then if it bites you, you won't get malaria. And you know, the thing is, for a mosquito that is not infected, if it bites somebody that has been infected, then it will carry
it from that person.
Take it to that person and take it to another person.
Now, Doc, you have to educate us here. So where the parasite is not living in space, is it?
No, it's not living in space. So it lives in humans, in infected person. So once the mosquito, I mean, and also in the mosquitoes.
Yes.
So, and for the mosquito, for the malaria parasite to survive in the mosquitoes, of course, it has to have the right humidity, the right temperature to survive. But once it's able to do that and it bites the human host, it introduces the parasite to the person, the parasite enters the blood and then looks nicely for the liver, goes into the liver
and hides there
and stays, and is there for about from day 6 when it bites to about 15 days. And it just doesn't sit there, it replicates, it begins to multiply. And then gets introduced into the bloodstream. When it gets into the bloodstream, that's when it now begins the danger.
That's when
it
you
now
see
attacks.
The
No, it attacks the red cells. You know, you don't forget it has multiply. So now there are so many of them that go after the red cells. And then when they enter the red cells, they also multiply there.
Again.
And then each red cell busts. You know, right now there are so many parasites in the blood that have attacked different red cells. And even there, they multiply again, and then they bust, and they get released into the bloodstream again. And these are things. So you find anybody that has malaria, typically, they may manifest the symptoms between the 10 and 4 weeks after they get infected.
Yes.
And in a few cases, the symptoms may not even manifest for several months.
And this multiplication continues.
And it continues. Now, also, you know, don't forget that we have talked about the ones that get released into the bloodstream.
Yes.
Cause the symptoms. So if the person gets tested for malaria, the person can be treated. But there are a few that may still stay back in the liver, and they can still get reintroduced into the bloodstream.
In spite of the treatment?
In spite of the treatment. If they are still in the liver, they are in the liver while the person gets treated. After the treatment, they can get reintroduced, causing the person to have a recurrence.
So, now, if we say we want to eradicate malaria, how are we going to do that if the malaria can find space to stay back in the liver after the treatment?
Yes, that's a very good question. Don't forget that even if it stays back in the liver, it will manifest. Now, if in that person's environment, in that human host environment, the environment has been well controlled, and the vectors around have been taken care of. So even that one iodine in the liver will still come out and will get treated. So we can eradicate it. And for countries that eradicate malaria, how they are being said to be malaria-free is once there are no cases of malaria for 3 consecutive years, then the country is certified.
3 consecutive years, yes. Not a single reported case of malaria then in the hospitals.
In the hospitals in such a country, then the country is said to have eradicated malaria.
The day Nigeria achieves that, I'm sure there will be a party.
It's possible.
But you say it's possible.
It's possible. That's what you and I will do. You're not a medical professional, but I mean, through programs like this, the campaign is very important in eradicating the disease.
But Doc, isn't it not funny? Isn't it ironic? The parasite stays inside the mosquito. It does not kill the mosquito.
The mosquitoes are killed by the vector control programs, the insecticide-treated nets,
yes,
and the indoor residual spraying.
So why would the malaria parasite kill the mosquito itself? Why would it?
Oh, no, that's the environment where it thrives.
Amazing.
So it won't kill it. It will stay there and thrive there until the mosquito finds the right host and then introduces the Plasmodium parasite into the right host.
So that is why we need to also control our environment to be sure that the mosquitoes don't grow in that environment.
Don't grow in that environment. And despite everything that's been done to control your environment, the insecticide-treated nets, even for, it's not just in the rural areas, even in the urban centers, yes, especially where you have children, you know, it's good to have them and to protect them from malaria, and for pregnant women. Because don't forget that for pregnant women, though there's a program of the intermittent prevention of preventive treatments in pregnancy, but the less they get bitten by malaria,
the better for them
and the better for their unborn baby, and the better for them. Because for pregnant women, it causes anemia in pregnancy, it causes the baby to have low birth weight, you know, and it's also one of the causes of maternal mortality, you know, apart from one of the causes of that spare, you know, mother can die and the child can die. So
just malaria.
All
right, you have all heard it. And I'm sure that you will let the conversation end there. So I would like to thank Dr. Tukumba Bajide. Thank you very much again for coming on Close Flow and for the wealth of information and knowledge and lessons we have learned from you. So all of us are very careful now so that we can just make sure that Nigeria is free of malaria. Nigeria is rid of malaria. We have to do something about that.
So that we can be among the countries.
Yes.
That will be
enjoy the rest of the world. Okay, so that is your campaign message. Go and make sure that Nigeria is free of malaria. Look at your environment. Make sure you get tested. You know, once you feel like you have malaria, before you get treated. And then get your treated net and get all the other things that you needed just by the way doctor said it. Thank you for watching. Don't forget to share with your friends. www.ntlnc.com, www.youtube.com/NTA2Lagos. Share with your friends and let's get this done. Thank you and bye for now.